First, for anyone interested in historic preservation and sort of the broad concepts of maintaining an old home, if you go to the Landmark Society site under rehab, I wrote a book 20 years ago called Rehab Rochester, and it's available online there, okay, and also through the City of Rochester site. And then 2 years ago, I published this Window Sash Bible, which is why I take these road trips every winter now. A lot of people are in the belief that they have to have new windows for energy efficiency, and the vinyl window and the replacement window people are just very happy to come out and tell us why they think that's true too. But the truth is that it's possible to rehab our old windows so that they function almost as efficiently as a new replacement window. The key word there is almost. If I sit across the table from the window salesman and I have a little battle with them about efficiency, they will beat me in numbers, but the numbers only mean pennies in a year, okay? One of the main reasons we like old windows, the main reason, is they look right. They were chosen to go with the house. They're an indication of the technology of glass and windows that were available at the time, okay? Another reason, a second reason, is because of old growth wood, all right? The wood that was used to make a window and to build our houses, to make the doors, was old growth. It was wood from forests that had not been felled in the history of our country. The trees grew tall in the forest. They were limbless up 30 feet, maybe. And over centuries, there's a compression of growth rings that makes the wood rot and insect resistant. You can look at these later, but here's an example of this. I have a 2x4, which is a real 2x4, from an old home, which has probably 80 growth rings. Here's one from a lumber company from just recently. I think it has 12 years. So that soft grain in between those is usually susceptible to rot and insect infestation. So the old growth wood is one reason we can't buy that anymore. All right. The second reason is the joinery. The joinery on many of our old windows is far superior. It's just not used in window making anymore. And so one reason you still have your old windows in your house, even if they've been abused or even if they've been neglected for 100 years, is because the joinery was just so fine, okay? Takes a lot of abuse. Another thing that a lot of people don't know is that your old windows can be retrofitted with weather strips, weather sealing materials, that are better than what you'll get with the high-end new window, okay? In this example, I've shown the traditional zinc weather stripping that was used from about 1900 up to 1960, okay? And another version of bronze. There are a lot of different kinds, okay, that can be retrofitted into your window. Back to that old growth wood. This is a 150-year-old partial windowsill, okay? And to you, it probably looks rotten sitting there, all right? But I would defy you to take your pocket knife, a screwdriver, a chisel, and show me that it's rotten, because this piece of wood is as hard as the day it was put in. It was just neglected for 100 years, all right? This sort of deterioration can be repaired very effectively for a long, long time. You can't have real rot, but in this case, this can be repaired. A lot of the deterioration we see in windows also is not the fault of the window. So this is the bottom rail and the style intersection on an old-fashioned double-hung window, the bottom sash, okay? And you see that it rotted 3 inches up into the style, okay? The reason it rotted 3 inches up into the style is no fault of the window, no fault of the old growth, beautiful white pine. It's because they didn't prime the bottom of it. The capillaries run up, and it sucked moisture up for 100 years. That's not bad for 100 years, though, okay? Your new vinyl windows, I have to do this quick. Your new vinyl windows have about a 10-year life. The better quality ones might last longer. However, the wider the window, the quicker it will fail, all right? I'm a good one to ask because I see them by the thousands, okay? A good replacement window, there's no such thing as an average size window, but for a 1920s house, 1910s 20 house, let's just say for argument that an average window is 32 inches by 60 inches tall, okay? So I guess Wonder Windows will put that in for $189. There's probably $50 worth of labor in that, and so the window's worth maybe $100. There's not much quality there, folks, and they do fall apart badly. A high-quality replacement window for that opening I just mentioned is in the $800, $900 range. That's for a Marvin, an Anderson, Pella, although I can't recommend Pella, okay? My point with that is that for those kind of dollars, you can typically fix your old windows to last another 100 years. Think about it that way. A lot of people complain, well, I've had my cords replaced on my double hung windows, but the cords broke in 5 years, and so, you know, the cords aren't any good anymore. And that's because the handyman or the carpenter or whoever did it went to the hardware store and bought the cord. And I love your corner hardware store, but they are in a bad way these days trying to compete with Lowe's and Home Depot and the other big box stores. And so they sell cheap sash cord. It's cheap, $6 for 100 feet maybe. Sash cord costs more like $30 for 100 feet. If you know where to get it, you can get the same product that was used in your windows 100 years ago, made by the same manufacturer, the same product, okay, which will last. I find this hanging 50, 60, 70 years later, the good stuff, okay. And a lot of people will say, yeah, but Steve, nylon is a great product, or synthetics. And it is on the north side of the house where the sun never hits. It might last 100 years, but if the sun shines on those products, it falls apart, okay? If your house is from the 30s to the 60s and has old-fashioned double-hung windows, it may have these spiral balances. This is a Caldwell balance. These were invented, originated, and made here in Rochester. They aren't now, but they always were. These are still available. That cost $5, so it's not a big deal to replace them. This is a beautiful thing. This is patented July 1892. Well, the Pullman Company started making clock spring balances here. Pullman, Caldwell, the American Sash Balance Company all made what were called clock spring balances. There's a tape that comes out of there, took the place of an old-fashioned sash cord. These are still made here, okay? We can still get them. They don't look like this, but same principle, okay? And this is what's called a block and tackle balance. This is probably what most modern windows have. There are two really thin nylon cords in there, you know. That's why they don't last a long time, these balances, but they can be replaced too, you know, on your more modern windows. This is one side of an old-fashioned storm window, okay? This is something I do a lot. I'm doing it less and less as I get older. I used to complain about tradespeople that didn't want to do hard work, and, plumbers only want to install toilets. They don't want to do hard, so I'm getting to be the same way. But anyway, this is like a piece of an original storm window. And one of the things that I do a lot for people, because they don't like the looks of an aluminum storm window, an aluminum storm window is not as efficient as an old-fashioned wooden storm window, is take their old wood storms, cut a rebate out in the bottom so that we can put in a little aluminum framed storm panel that can be removed from the inside, put that in the winter, insert a little screen panel into it in the summer, then they can leave their wooden storm frame in all the time. We do that a lot. I don't know if any of you are interested in modern windows, whether they're modern new windows or modern replacement windows, but I keep a list. I didn't bring it today, but I keep a list. It's 2 pages long of single space of window failures, window lawsuits, and window disasters. Okay, anybody that wants to contact me online can do that. It's windowsashbible.com, and I'll send you my list, okay, because it never ceases to amaze me how many failures there are of modern windows, and you have to watch that. You have to understand how they carry on, because when brand XYZ window fails, then very often they just change the name of the window and move on. Because I'm involved in this restoration of old window business, we have conferences all over the United States, and occasionally when I go to these conferences, the people from Marvin and Anderson and Colby and a lot of others will be there. And when those of us get up and talk about how terrible new windows are, those people will never respond because they know what's going on. So there's a little subdivision in Brighton with all new houses, and lady called me on Labor Day, and she said, "Mr. Jordan, I'm desperate." Okay. And I went over to her house, built in 2003, all new Pella windows, and she said, "Well, I opened my window this morning because it was a cool morning, and the glass fell out to the ground." Okay. She said, "We never open our windows." And what she had was a casement Pella window with aluminum cladding on the outside. What happens is, and it happens to all the brands, is water gets caught behind that aluminum cladding. The water can get in from the outside, maybe, or it can be from excessive condensation or icing on the inside, maybe, but it gets stuck behind the aluminum cladding. So the window begins to rot, and the wood in the window isn't very good. It's what we call finger jointed. It's pieces glued together, okay? And it's not good wood in the first place. And so then the windows just fall apart behind the cladding. So eventually then people crank their windows out and the windows fall apart. I see this every week, okay? So, you know, you should know about that and follow it. If you're interested in new windows, all I can say is buy the best one that you can buy by someone who will stand behind it, okay? You have any questions for me?
Hi, I'm Ann Pouch, and I live at Penfield Road, which is a house that is now 202 years old. And 22 years ago, we took this man's advice. We have 55 windows, and they have beautiful wavy glass and still in some of them. So we took his advice, and we had a man come and reglaze every single pane. Some of the windows have 12 panes. One or two have 16 panes. So this is a lot of panes. And 22 years later, we are still enjoying the benefits of how good that is, and it saved us so much money. So I encourage you, if you have good old hardwood frames on your windows, just do it.
Thank you. I was worried where you were going to go with that.
What'd you say?
I was worried where you were going to go with that. You waited a long time to get to the point. You could have said it was a disaster. I should also say that right now I am restoring, and restoring has a legal meaning, by the way, but I am restoring the windows in the Sodus Point Lighthouse, 13 windows in the Keeper's House, which were put in 1870. And they, although terribly neglected, are in great condition and going to be beautiful, I hope, for another 100 years.
Stephen, you did Stone Tolan House windows.
We did the Stone Tolan House windows in about 1995 or 6, something like that, with volunteers. Yep. Yes, sir.
If you have an older historic house with older windows but don't have the original wooden storms,
yep,
or wooden screens, they're gone.
Mm-hmm.
And you have an aluminum type storm window on there that you'd like to have,
mm-hmm,
removed. How do you do that? What do you do in that case?
You mean, are you saying that you might like to go back to the old wooden storm?
Yeah.
Well, I have three people that I know that make them. Okay. So you can still get them, keeping in mind that a wooden storm and screen is a premier product and expensive. Yeah,
okay.
Expensive.
But they're the kind you can install and then take the storms and screens off from the inside?
Absolutely, you can do that. And uh-huh, there's a fellow up in Adams, New York, just south of Watertown a little bit, that makes a beautiful unit. And I just put some in the old school building on French Road, across from French Road School. A man lives in that house. He just purchased some from that fellow up in Adams. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, that's possible.
Thank you.
Yes.
What about storing rotten storm window frames?
Can you repeat his question?
He asked me about replacing rotted storm window frames. Well, it depends on how rotted they are, and you get into a decision of, is it cheaper to build new or make a repair? Okay. And sometimes it's simpler to, well, there are a whole lot of factors, you know, because they have to be reglazed and painted and hardwired and fitted. So sometimes it's cheaper to fix it. But if the whole bottom rail is rotted out and it's gone into the joinery, then it might be better just to make a new one. I have a problem with storm windows, and this is not easy solvable, and that's that if you are not careful in the construction of a new storm window, they will rot, because a lot of people will build them out of ponderosa pine, which rots. So one reason wooden storm windows are so expensive is because the wood used to make a durable, rot-free storm window is a premium product. As an example, at Sodus Lighthouse this week, I bought a piece of five-quarter. Five-quarter is a piece of lumber that's an inch and an eighth thick. I bought a piece of five-quarter by 8 inches by 8 feet, and that one board cost me $100. Okay, so we're talking real money to buy good wood for a storm window. Yes?
Any general comments about clad windows, as in Anderson, which we have elsewhere?
But we have had several problems with, mm-hmm, the plastic cladding.
How baking. Old are they?
Oh, 93.
They have lived their useful life. You can't do anything about them.
Thanks for the question. That was what I was trying to ask.
They have lived.
Where
they
am
have
I?
Lived out their useful life. The useful life, even on a high quality window, is 20 to 30 years, and that's it.
What am I going to do?
You're going to have to replace them.
With same?
That's the problem with the replacement window deal. It's once you do it, you've bought into it, and they're going to wear out, and you're going to have to replace them again, and they're going to wear out, and you're going to have to replace them again. And for example, sir, I built a little vacation cottage in the Ozark Mountains in 1988. We finished it, and we put in Anderson windows, and they were expensive. And they have lived out their useful life. I cringe at the thought of replacing those windows because, number one, it doesn't seem to me like it's been that long. Number two, they should last longer than that. Number three, it's very expensive. My saving grace is that my house, our little vacation house, has a 3.5-foot overhang so that no water or sun has ever hit my windows, and so they're still in perfect place. But on a window that's highly exposed with no overhang, they're just not going to last past 25 years.
These are the one that gets the most abuse is south-facing 12-foot patio door, three panels.
Yeah. The other problem you've indicated is they have a plastic cladding, and the plastic cladding is subject to UV deterioration, whereas the aluminum cladding, which is what's on a Marvin or a Pella, is more durable.
The corners have cracked at the weld.
Okay. Yeah. They won't help you. You're outside the warranty period. Another thing about this wood, you should understand, we ran out of old growth wood in the 1920s, and everyone knew it, and it's well documented. So in the 1930s, they started treating all windows and exposed pieces and parts with pentachlorophenol, PCP, which was a chemical that resisted rot and insects, and man, it was a great chemical, and it worked. Nothing has ever worked like it since. Unfortunately, it killed everybody that used it. And so, it's a carcinogen, and there were horrible implications from it, okay? And some of the sites where it was used are Superfund sites now. So they took that product off the market in 1982, and every window since 1982 has rotted. Okay, and there have been lots and lots of lawsuits about this. And if you ask the manufacturers, they'll say, well, we think we've got a good product now, but I don't know. We do know that the products from 10 years ago are rotting. Will what you buy now rot? I don't know. Yes.
We're all here because we live in the historical district.
Uh-huh.
We're all looking for answers to keep our homes historic, safe, weather resistant. But can we change anything in our homes without permits?
I'm not here as someone from the local community preservation commission.
Okay.
However, normally these do not affect what's inside your house. They normally affect what's viewed from the street. So,
but what you're talking about are windows, which are viewed from the street.
Yep.
Which we're not supposed to change.
No, that's not true, and you're right on target. Anything from the interior, we have no jurisdiction over. You can do pretty much anything you want into the interior of the building, subject to getting a remodeling permit. But in terms of working with the Historic Preservation Board, the board's worked on many sites over the last several years where people wanted to modify their windows, and you're right. The intent is to make sure that you have good, you know, a good window that's going to preserve the site and help protect it. But the board has worked with people on several occasions to do that, and they'd be happy to work with you. We can talk about that after the meeting for a little while if you'd like.
If there are not any more questions, I've done my time.
Actually, I do have
one more. Yes.
One more.
Yes.
Could you just comment on the 100-year-old sash that you showed as an example before? What red?
That
the
piece
rework,
of wood.
Yeah. What would you do to
that.
Make it new?
Okay. You sand the top off till it's bright wood. That's bright wood on the end. Okay. In other words, you take off the punky, deteriorated top down to a sound substrate. Okay. You take a 5-in-1 tool or a pick or something, and you dig out the paint and the putty or whatever's been put in those cracks. These cracks are the soft spring growth that deteriorated, okay? Then you have two methods. The modern method is with epoxies. When I say epoxy, I don't mean Bondo. I mean epoxy, which is a two-part component and very expensive. I use West System. There are a lot of other epoxies. Okay, that works pretty good. Sand it down smooth again. It's not quite that simple, but it works. The old-fashioned method, which I actually have done just recently, again, sand it down, clean out the cracks, saturate that with boiled linseed oil and turpentine. It will penetrate halfway down that board, okay? Let that dry. Fill the cracks with just putty.
So now I've got a sash, though, that's different size dimensionally than I started out with. I thought you were going to have a magic elixir that you pour on it or something to
maintain
dimension.
Well, you can build up with epoxy. Not with the second method, linseed oil and putty, you cannot. But with epoxy, you can build it up if you want to. Okay, but if a window sill is too gone, I mean, and if it's mushy rot, then you should just take it out and put in a new window sill.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. All right, thank you all.
Our final presenter today is Bruce Zaretsky of Zaretsky Associates. He's worked in the landscape and contracting business since 1979. His monthly column is entitled On the Level, featured in professional trade journals Watershapes, which is read around the world. He is the consultant to the town of Penfield and for landscaping. And just this past year, 2015, he won the National Association of Landscape Professionals Community Stewardship Award. So I'm pleased to welcome him today to talk to us about historic landscaping.
The thing about landscape design, it's kind of apropos that I'm going last because the house is usually built that we come in and we play. But to be able to talk about every type of home and how to renovate or historically design or re-landscape would take hours. So I figured, let me just do this. Let me go through a history of landscape design and architecture and designers and just kind of give you an overview. And then you can always go play online. There's a lot of sources. At the end, I've got a lot of books listed out. Jim, did you print out the handout that I had given you, sent you?
I could bring it out.
Okay, we do have a handout that I had put together with listings of all sorts of resources. So let's do this. Let's just start a little bit with the history of garden design and landscape design. Gardens have been around since the Egyptians. The Egyptians were building parks. They were building gardens. They had all sorts of facilities for outdoor use. The Hanging Gardens of Babylon is one of the most well-known Seven Wonders of the World examples. The ancient Greeks, back to the 6th century BC, they would do memorial gardens. I design memorial gardens today. It's funny, Cynthia was talking about borrowing things from previous people. Everything is borrowed. It's so true. Nothing is really new. We adapt, we make some changes, but we're borrowing the same ideas that were in the 6th century. Public gardens. The Greeks were very much into symmetry. A lot of their architecture, you'll see, is very symmetrical, and their gardens were. If you want to be really true to the design, cypresses, firs, oaks, sycamores, palms, these were all things that were being used in the 6th century BC. The Romans, too. They were really into the idea of urban spaces, urban gathering spaces. So they had public gardens, but then people who had means, like people today, would have private gardens too. You'd see them all different types and styles, but look at some of the plants. Boxwoods, I was designing a garden for a client this morning. I was using boxwoods, they love boxwood hedge. Laurels, myrtles, you name it. These things were being used thousands of years ago. One of my, there's a lot of styles that I really love and a lot of people love, and the Asian garden, particularly Japanese gardens, are really, really inspiring on many, many levels. They've been around again for thousands of years. The Japanese in particular, really into recreating nature. A lot of what we do when we do a Japanese or an Asian garden is you take nature and you scale it down to the size of your garden. So you'll make use of borrowed views, recreating nature. There's always going to be something with water or the insinuation of water. You don't need to have a water fall or anything, but you can create the effect of having one with dry creek beds, dry waterfalls, and even using certain plants. in all seasons, especially Japanese gardens, are very, very inspiring and beautiful and serene to look at. But a lot of thought goes into them. I did a small garden for a client last week, and we just did this little space that was maybe 10 feet by 10 feet. And how much time it took me just to place the rocks to make it feel like it belonged. It's amazing. You don't just throw things in there. One thing that's really inspiring to me is the garden that Rio Anji in Kyoto, Japan, has 15 stones in that garden. And it's designed such that no matter where you go in that garden, you can only see 14 of them. I mean, the amount of thought and time and effort that went into creating that, just it blows me away. We move to the Renaissance. A lot of what we call formal gardens, where the term formal gardens come from. A lot of symmetry, boxwood parterres, or in larger scale, you'd see holly, you'd see privet, you'd see all different types of parterres with these really cool patterns put into them. So you had that sense of symmetry, but then they also would start moving away into a more irregular style. And then again, we talked about borrowing or being inspired by other people. They were inspired by India, Spain, Morocco. Now we moved to the United States, and people came over from Europe to make their way in the New World. 99.999% of the people did not care about pretty gardens. They had no concern over having pretty gardens. Their gardens were growing food. They would grow food outside their kitchen. They'd have livestock. They'd have chickens in there. They would, you know, basically what today we call a kitchen garden or an herb garden, this was a way of life. Now, if they wanted something ornamental, you'd see a lilac, a viburnum, a spirea, some type of ornamental shrub here and there. But overall, gardens, and even up until the mid-20th century, what I do for a living was not really prevalent for the average human being. People with means, people with money, had fancy gardens to show off and be, you know, very ornamental. But most people of our ilk were still trying to survive. We weren't thinking about garden design in particular. And in the United States, garden design really didn't explode until the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and now it's like, you know, HGTV. And Jerry was so right. I mean, HGTV is a two-edged sword. On the one hand, it's made all of you aware of what I do for a living. On the other hand, it has totally deceived you as to what things cost to do in what we do for a living. Mind-bogglingly deceiving. So we move into the 18th century. Some people started to have some means. They started building homes that might have some influence from Europe, Georgian-style federal, Adams-style colonials. And then there were certain things that they would do around those homes. Clumps of trees, shrubs, perennials around a perimeter to define the property. You'd have a lawn. Lawns started to become more prevalent. Lawns were a status symbol in the United States. People, if I have a lawn, that means I had money, because you know what it took to mow a lawn in the 1700s? It was people with scythes out by hand mowing them off, which means you're hiring people to do this kind of work. But so there would be trees throughout the lawn. There would be water features and grottos and bridges and other things like that. Again, people with means. This is a really interesting book. I have not read it, but I did some research on it. Ann Layton, American Gardens in the 18th Century. So if you have a home that was built in the 18th century and you want to recreate the gardens, here's one option that you can really get a lot of good information out of. We move it to the 19th century. Again, you know, there was a lot of homes being built in Georgian, Italian, at Queen Anne, Victoria, all the way down the line. And in most cases, if a designer designed gardens, it kind of played off the flavor of the house. Make sense? I mean, when I design for clients, I always tell them there's three parameters of what makes me design their home. The architecture of the house, what they want, and what falls out of my head. But architecture is really the prevalent thing. You look at a home as a designer and you go, oh, I see something that complements that home. So Georgian style went back to the parterres of boxwoods. You had very formal gardens, very symmetrical. You use some flowering shrubs. There'd be blossoming trees. Basically what you saw in the Renaissance gardens. It was kind of a flavor coming off of that. Italianate style was not significantly different. The one thing I did learn about this when I was doing some research is they would have a service area, they call it, but that's where the kitchen garden would go. So going back to the colonial times, there'd be a kitchen garden outside the kitchen, or the service entrance, the service area. And we're getting into formal lawns. Anybody that knows me knows that I am so anti-lawn. I do talks similar to this for landscape contractors, and I love when I get all the maintenance guys in the room. And boy, some of them just hate me so much because I make fun of lawnmowers and weed whips and blowers and things like that. But lawns, you know, lawns have their place. There's no question about it. But they also, you know, can get a little overbearing. Edward Budding is the guy we blame for it because he invented the first practical lawnmower in 1830, and it all went from there. And so you see all these fancy things. I mean, there is a lot to be said for the smell of a freshly cut lawn and when you see the beautiful lines mowed into them. But when I see a house with 3 acres of lawn and all the chemicals and everything going on it, I'm going off into a different tangent here, but lawns became very prevalent on some of these homes. Let's go to that. Queen Anne style, you'd see maybe an occasional tree in the front of the lawn, in the lawn area, clumps of shrubs, again, along the property line. Typically, when you see that, people are defining their properties. They're kind of staking out their space. But lots of bright colors. You'd see a lot of annuals being planted. They had, Queen Anne's had these big, beautiful porches you sit on, and so people would plant stuff like Dutchman's pipe and things like that to create these vines growing up along the edge of the porch. And then we move into the 20th century. So I'm a huge fan of arts and crafts. I love mission-style arts and crafts, green and green, Frank Lloyd Wright and going into prairie style. I love those flavors of homes. So when I pull up to a client's home and I see that they have a house like this, I love that because I get to play with it. You'd see lots of large stone terraces and patios. I always say that arts and crafts is a very bold style, so the garden should be bold. Big stones. I go with bright monochromatic colors. I'll do masses of red if they have, say, a red front door, and I'll play off of the boldness of the architecture of the house. And again, lawns. You'll see every home has lawns, especially in America. But it's funny because for me, the arts and crafts and the prairie styles are bold but simple. And it plays very much off Asian architecture and Asian garden design as well. So if you look, a Japanese garden would not be out of place in an arts and crafts home or a prairie style home because that's where a lot of the influence comes from. And then we start getting further on, colonial revival. People started building homes to play off what was, you know, whether it was in Europe or, you know, early America. And again, you know, it's people with means would build homes like these. I read that the Centennial Exhibition in Philadelphia really kindled this revival spirit to be able to build homes like this. You'd see a lot of straight lines, central axis. You'd see old-fashioned plants, going back to the old-fashioned style plants like lilacs, spireas, viburnums, things that were around in the 1600s. And I'm going to show you a book at the end of this that you can buy a book that will list every plant used in gardens way back into the 1600s. You can go right to the exact plant if you want to be that precise. You'd see a lot of white picket fences. We just recently did one for a client in Brighton. We did a white picket fence for them that played very well off the architecture of the house. And, you know, various things like herb gardens, simple evergreen foundation plantings. Most foundation plantings really started because foundations started to become ugly. So they would plant to hide the foundation. And then what happens is it becomes this. These monstrosities of just stuff shoved. And this is my own industry's fault because we'd go in there and someone would go in, and I don't know, I can't tell what these plants are from this picture, but someone would go in and stick in a really cute little forsythia by the front door. Now, a true forsythia grows 15 feet. So then you start pruning them into bowling balls and lollipops, and you start really just destroying the integrity of the design and the flavor, plus creating a maintenance nightmare. And Jim Costello can tell you from my consulting with the town of Penfield, I'm constantly telling developers, don't do this. And they think I'm just being a pain, but I'm actually trying to save them money in the long run, less maintenance. But this is what most homes have become. And I try to avoid that when I'm doing my work. So there were a lot of designers in America American garden designers who really were influential in bringing it to what it is today. Bernard McMahon is considered the father of urban American horticulture. You know, back in the late 1700s, early 1800s, he curated seeds that Lewis and Clark brought back from their expeditions, and he was highly influential on Thomas Jefferson, who was very much a plant person. Andrew Jackson Downing, who was one of the most, as it says there, influential designers, he wrote a book in 1841 on landscape design and landscape gardening. It's almost 200 years ago already. And of course, Frederick Law Olmsted, who everybody knows he designed Central Park. Who didn't know he designed Central Park? Nobody knows, doesn't know that. But they also you also know he designed Highland Park here in Rochester, and Genesee Valley Park, and Maplewood Park, and Seneca Park, and how about Jones Square, and Brown Square. And what I love about this photo is that is unmistakably Frederick Law Olmsted with the pathways going all over the place. And when we again talk about influential, he is highly influential in what I do for a living. I don't do a ton of large-scale commercial or municipal design, but I do healing garden design. We've done some design for Rochester General Hospital, and if you flew over in an airplane, you would see my pathways looking like that, right out of Frederick Law Olmsted. On and on. Grace Tabor was one of the early, very few female landscape designer slash architects in the United States. She lived for 100 years, and she was really a champion of designing for you and me, for middle class America, not the people with a lot of money. She was also before her time in using native plants. She wanted to use native plants, and it would just be more conservative, it would be more socially conscious and, you know, conservationist, I guess is would be the word I'd use, less water, less resources to keep the gardens going. So she really was very influential on where we are today. Now we're getting into some people that I really, really have a great deal of respect for. Thomas Church, he wrote a book called Gardens for People in 1955. I still use this book today. I'm still influenced. He was the first one to design curved pools. Has anybody ever seen this pool? Really? Thomas Church, this is called the Donnelly Pool in California. He walked onto the site and saw the hills in the distance and designed the pool to play off the hills in the distance. It was one of the first kidney-shaped pools done in the United States. He was an amazing designer. He was really into using these like amoeba-like forms, but also very hard-line geometric. This is the design for the Donnelly Pool right here, early picture of it as well. He was renowned in the late 20th century as one of the pioneers of landscape design. He would do small spaces. He would create these little hidden alcove spaces in his gardens. Amazing, amazing work. Love this guy's work. And just to give you a sense, here is the Donnelly Pool, and here are two projects that we've done in the last 10 years. Where was I influenced? We don't call it stealing, we call it being influenced. But yes, I'm stealing these ideas. You know, you can't not, when you're a designer, you can't not look at other people's work and be influenced by it, whether it repels you or it draws you in. Thomas Church draws me in. I'm not going to show you anybody that repels me. The only limit to your garden is the boundaries of your imagination. I mean, doing things like this, just building a deck around trees. Buy that book. It's still available on Amazon, $43. Buy it. Wolfgang Ulm, James Van Sweden, Uma Van Sweden. Anybody been to the Chicago Botanic Garden? Wow, you guys got to get out. These two guys started what was called the Bold Romantic Garden. They started a movement in 1970s, creating these bold planting layouts, these big, full meadow-type plantings, planting right up against the pools that they designed. So you can see, you know, again, more geometric, very Thomas Church, but look at the bold plantings right around the water feature, not the 3-foot apron of concrete around the pool, actually designing around the pool. Okay, so there's Uma Van Sweden, and there is Zaretsky. So you become influenced. See the details, the inlay details. Again, this is Van Sweden, this is me. so you can be influenced. These are three, has a tiny little courtyard right on East Avenue, 10 feet by 20 feet max. And you can create these really dramatic little features and then larger scale plantings. This is actually the front of a suburban home in Victor. In all of the arts, the best garden designers take risks. Only by taking risks can you come out with something exciting and original. And that's just one of their books. There's three more, and there's more in your list. Okay, one non-American, Pete Outdoll. If anybody been to the High Line, Millennium Park in Chicago, that's Pete Outdoll. Again, he's a Dutch garden designer, very well known for doing these large scale. This is actually at his nursery. I love that. I'm not a big fan of sheared stuff, but I love that. But look at the bold grass plantings here. These large scale. This is actually a river of salvia. This is Millennium Park in Chicago. Big, bold, dramatic gardens, large scale. And look what I did. Pete Outdoll. So you can be influenced by anybody. He's really into the death of plants. A plant's only worth growing if it looks good when it's dead. That's a great, great book if you're into plant design. Andrea Cochran out in California, she does very, very simple detail, mass plantings, minimalist design style. This is where a lot of our garden design has gone in our country, especially in more progressive areas. So. There's Andrea. See the masses right here of whatever that plant may be, some type of succulent. And here's one of my jobs here, not too far from here. Masses, just masses, very simple. Topher Delaney, I say she's out there, she's crazy. And I love her for it. She is really, really an amazing, amazing designer. She's in San Francisco. This was a design that was based on the scanning codes when you go to the store. So she does really interesting things. This project right here where she just wrapped some light up underneath the water feature and made it look like fire in reverse, amazing stuff. This was done for, she does a lot of healthcare garden design. This is actually for an Institute for the Blind. That's Braille. So it's done so there's some type of saying in there that's in Braille. She does really crazy, interesting things that whether you want to call it landscape design or not, it's still very, very cool. She is an artist. And this is a glass wall. It's a little difficult in this picture, but the light flows right up the wall. It's absolutely beautiful. And then where do I get my ideas? So in the 21st century, there's a lot about conservation, water capture, whether it's rain barrels, cisterns for capturing water off your downspouts. You're seeing a lot of rain gardens and bioswales. We did one a few years ago here, right at the Penfield Highway Department. We did a rain garden. Took an area that they had been dumping for years and years and years, right alongside Thousand Acre Swamp. And we cleaned it all up, planted it up and turned it into a rain garden. All the water from the highway department. Think about what's coming off those trucks. The salt, the oil that might be dripping, gas that might be dripping, is all filtered through this garden right here. And you're seeing a lot more along roadways. I noticed Brighton's done a bunch along Monroe Avenue where they're doing areas where it's water capture and filtration. That is garden design for the 21st century. That is where we're going. You're seeing a lot more green roofs and walls, and I have very strong opinions on green walls, and I've done a few myself. These two here we've done. We've also done a few green roofs. Green walls, I can spend hours talking about them, not always in a good way, but this is where a lot of which is where we're going with a lot of this stuff today. For those of you who really are into this stuff and don't have these books, this is a really good book if you're into, you know, your historic homes. I have this copy of this book in my car, and when I pull up to a client's house, if it's an older home, before I walk up, I always flip through the book and figure out what style house it is so I can sound like I really know what I'm talking about when I go up there. But also, I wanted to get my brain wrapped around what the architecture of the house is, and then I can go back if I need to research and I want to do something that's authentic. They might tell me they don't really care. Give me three boxwoods and a yew, and I'll be happy. But if they want something that's really architectural to the house, that book is invaluable. A few others, and these are all listed in your handouts, so I will shut up in any second now. This is the book that really, really matters. It has a listing of plants way back to 1630, I think, all different eras throughout American history, and you can have authentic lists of trees, shrubs, annuals, perennials, you name it. It's vegetables. It's all there. And questions, comments, opinions. Thank you.